Can you hear me? Yes, excellent. It is great to have you with us on this Sunday morning. A particular warm welcome if you're here for the baptism of Ivo. It is great to have you with us this morning, and the baptism is going to happen in just a couple of minutes. So the way that you can keep up to date with all the latest news and events of everything that's happening in the life of our church is via our weekly newsletter. And if you're not yet receiving that, please speak to me or one of the welcome team and we'll make sure to get you signed up so that you can keep up to date with everything that is happening in the life of the church. And just a note on that as well, to say that we are going to change the platform that we send our newsletter from in the next few weeks. So if it doesn't end up in your inbox at the normal time, please check your junk mail just in case it's made its way into there. You will hopefully receive one of these today, and make sure you don't leave the church building without. So this is one of our Christmas cards, which has information about everything that is happening over the Christmas period, all of our carol services and everything that's happening. So make sure that you get one of those before you leave so that you have all of that information. Let's pray as we start our service. Father, we thank you that you are here. We thank you that you are with us. We lift up the world, the nation, and our church to you now. We thank you for COP26, the UN Climate Summit that met earlier this month. We thank you for the world leaders that gathered there to think about how to take action against the climate crisis. And we pray for world leaders now to take that forward. We pray for wisdom for them to know how to make changes to tackle the climate crisis. And we pray for businesses, we pray for churches, restaurants, cafes, individuals to know as well how to make a difference, how to play a part in seeing change, one action at a time. Give us wisdom as individuals and as a church to know how to do that. And Father, we continue to pray for COVID as we still see cases rise and restrictions in place in different parts of the country and the world. We pray for continued wisdom for governments. And we pray for NHS staff and for teachers, all those on the front line of this, because it has been such a long time. And ultimately, God, we pray that we would see this pandemic come to an end. We know that all things are possible with you, and we pray this in your name. And today, as we celebrate the baptism of Ivo, we pray for all our children and young people in this church. We thank you for them. We thank you for the children's work and the youth work happening in the modular build next door. We thank you for the youngest in our congregation. We thank you for all the children and youth leaders too. I was reminded of this verse about Jesus when he was a child, when I was praying for our children and young people. Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And that is our prayer for the children and young people of our church too. And finally, we pray for anybody in our lives that we know to be struggling in any way. We thank you that you know them by name. You know exactly what they are going through, how they feel right now. We just lift them by name in our hearts to you now. Father, we pray that you would meet them, that you would meet their needs, and that they would know your peace with them that surpasses all knowledge and understanding. We pray all of this in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, we have come to the point of the baptism of Ivo, which is very, very exciting. So I'm going to hand over to Alan now as he leads us in that.
Hear me okay? Oh, hear me now? Fantastic. This is a really exciting time in the life of our church as we welcome a new person into our church family. And we're also praying for God's blessings on Ivo. And our prayer is, obviously, he's too young to make these promises by himself, but our prayer is that there'll never be a time when Ivo doesn't know about the Lord Jesus. And when he gets a bit older, he'll look back and say, thank you, Mum and Dad, that you brought me up in the family of the church. So would Todd and Harriet and Ivo, would you like to come and join me? And would the godparents, would you like to come and join me too? Mum and Dad, if I could give you one of those. Godparents, if you'd like to come to this side. If you'd like to take one of these each. Brilliant. Everyone got one? Do you need one? If you share. Brilliant. Wonderful. Hopefully the words are going to come up on the screen for you, the church family. Brilliant. So baptism is a visible sign of God's love. It symbolizes the Christian faith that Jesus died to wash away from those who trust him the guilt of our wrongs, and that by faith in him we can be united in his death and his resurrection to receive everlasting life. And the first question is for you, the whole church family. Faith is the gift of God to his people. In baptism, the Lord is adding to our number those whom he is calling. People of God, will you welcome this child and uphold them in their new life in Christ? Great. And now some questions for parents and godparents. Parents and godparents, the church receives Ivo with joy. Today we are trusting God for his growth in faith. Will you pray for him, draw him by your example into the community of faith, and walk with him in the way of Christ?
With the help of God, we will.
In baptism, this child begins their journey in faith. You speak for them today, but will you care for him? Help him to take his place with the life and the worship of Christ's church.
With the help of God, we will.
And now for the decision. In baptism, God calls us out of darkness into his marvelous light. To follow Christ means dying to sin and rising to new life with him. And I'm going to ask you six statements, three of them about turning away from some of the things that get in the way of our relationship with God, and then three positive things of turning to Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. Therefore, I ask you, do you reject the devil and all rebellion against God?
I reject them.
Do you renounce the deceit and the corruption of evil?
I renounce them.
Do you repent of the sins that separate us from God and neighbour?
I repent them.
Do you turn to Christ as Saviour? Do you submit to Christ as Lord?
I submit to Christ.
Do you come to Christ, the way, the truth, and the life?
I come to Christ.
Brilliant. If there's any children, do you want to? You're welcome to come to the front if you want to get a better view, but feel free to come. Don't be shy. You want to see what happens to little Ivo? Feel free to come to the front. And actually, I could need a hand. Would someone like to come and help me pour the water? Do we have any volunteers? No. They're all terrified and shy. I will pour the water then. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gift of water to sustain, to refresh, and to cleanse all life. And we thank you for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Jesus in his death. And by it we share in his resurrection. And we pray for this child who will be baptized in this water today. May he come to full faith in you, be renewed by your image, walk by the light of your faith, and come to share the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now, Ivo, for the fun bit. How are we going to do? Hi, buddy. Ivo Ian Philip Williams, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son Ooh, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Give him a round of applause. Ooh. Well done. Well done. Well done, buddy. Oh, you want to hold the towel? Oh, all these people clapping you. May God, who has received you by baptism into his church, pour upon you the riches of his grace, that within the company of Christ's pilgrim people, you may daily be renewed by his anointing spirit and come to the inheritance of the saints in glory. Okay. A bit of water. Sign the cross upon you. Christ claims you for his own. Receive the sign of the cross. Do not be ashamed to confess the faith of Christ crucified. And we all say together, fight valiantly as a disciple of Christ against sin, the world, and the devil, and remain faithful to Christ to the end of your life. May Almighty God deliver you from the powers of darkness, restore in you the image of his glory, and lead you in the light and the obedience of Christ. Amen. Amen. Well done, buddy. You've been a star. Give you back to Dad. Sophie, can we have a candle? I'm going to give this to Mum and Dad to hold. And there's nothing magical, obviously, about a candle, but Jesus said he's the light of the world. And we pray that the light of the world is going to come into Ivo's life and will remain with him as he grows up and is nurtured in faith. So you'd like to light that for us, Sophie. God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and has given us a place with the saints in light. Well done. It's the first lesson we give curates, how to light a candle. Wonderful. We say together, you have received the light of Christ. Walk in this light all the days of your life. Shine as a light in the world to the glory of God the Father. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Ivo, by one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. And we say together, we welcome you into the fellowship of faith. We are children of the same Heavenly Father. We welcome you. And let me just pray for you, Ivo, final prayer, then we'll give you a wonderful round of applause. Heavenly Father, I want to pray for your blessing upon Ivo, upon Todd, upon Harriet, and upon the godparents. I pray that you'd give these parents wisdom as they bring this wonderful little boy up, that they'd give them the understanding to be amazing parents. And we pray for you, Ivo, that God's protection would be always upon you, and that there would be never a day that you won't know the love of the Lord Jesus in your life. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give Ivo a round of applause. Thank you, guys. Well done. You guys, you want to come sit down? Yes. Thank you. I'd like to invite the worship band to come up on stage. We're going to move into a time of worship now, and afterwards, Verlin's going to bring us our reading. So if you're able, would you like to stand? And let's worship the Lord.
Morning, Ivo. It was great seeing him last week, chatting away, and he's obviously very happy to be in church, and it's great to have him here, and it's great to have all of you with us. We are, as Alan says, all welcome in this place, and so let's join together, and we're just going to sing our worship to God, our Heavenly Father, who welcomes us with open arms. Thank you. So we just declare that this morning. Father God, you are greater, you are stronger. And Father, we just lift up to you as we were praying earlier for anyone that we know who is struggling at the moment. And we just declare that truth over them. And if there's anything that we are struggling with this morning, we declare that truth over that as well. That you are greater and you are stronger. Nothing is too difficult to overcome with you by our side.
Thank you.
think through things that you are thankful for. And just as we sing that through, that we fall at God's feet and we worship him. We're worshiping him because we are thankful for what he's done for us. Our worship is a response to what he has done in our lives and what he's done for us. As we just sing this through, just think about those things that you're thankful for and just in your heart, just declare those to the Lord.
This morning, we want to pray that you would stir a passion in each of our hearts, that you'd open our hearts to receive from you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's take a seat, and Verlin's going to come and bring us our reading. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Our reading this morning is from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 to 11, the Ten Commandments. And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, I am a jealous God, punishing children for the sin of their parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Fairlin, for that reading, one I'm sure some of us have heard before. But good morning and a warm welcome to you, especially if you are visiting us for the first time. It's lovely to see you with us. I hope you've had a great week, and I hope you feel part of this worshiping community this morning. We're beginning a new series called Living with Purpose this morning, and we run a course called the Alpha Course here at St. Saviour's. And one of the questions we often ask on the Alpha Course is there more to life than this? Is there more to life than this? That deep down, all of us want to have our lives mean something. And is our life more than just getting a job or the house, earning a good salary, going on holidays a few times a year, having a family, if that's what we want? Is that the meaning of life? Or is there more to life than that? Mark Twain, the author, said this, the two most important days in your life, the two most important days in your life are the day you were born and the day you find out why. And all of us want our lives to have some form of meaning or purpose. And faith is all about an adventure. So over the next few weeks, we're going to be thinking about the answer to that question. How can we live lives with purpose? We're going to be thinking about fellowship, that we're not called to do life alone, but we're called to do life in relationship with each other. We're going to look at discipleship. Jesus didn't ask us to say a prayer and then wait till we get to heaven, but he calls us to be disciples and apprentices, and what it means to follow Jesus and do the things that Jesus did in our lives today. We're going to look at ministry. That ministry is not just for the staff team and preachers and pastors and priests, but actually every single one of us is called into ministry. We all get gifts that God calls us to use. We're going to look at mission. God has a mission for the world, and we're invited to be part of this mission. So before we continue, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning, and these Ten Commandments, and we pray, Lord, that wherever we are at, in this journey of faith, that you'd speak to each one of us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. I asked you how your week had been. My week's been okay. My wife celebrated a birthday this week, so I thought I'd treat her. And we went to a spa morning. I've never been to a spa before. But we spent a morning in a spa, and we went for all these various treatments, and I found it was a little bit awkward, but she seemed to be enjoying it. I was looking forward to the massage At the end of the final treatment, I do a bit of sport, a bit of running, and go to the gym, and I have a few knots in my back, and I was looking forward to having a massage at the end. So we're sitting to the reception, both of us, and this very petite lady came in and said, Alan and Leah, time for your treatment. And I got excited, nice small petite lady. And as we walked into the corridor, the petite lady went with Leah, and this 6 foot big guy came up to me. And I was trying to work out what accent he had. He looked like Arnold Schwarzenegger. And maybe his accent was Austrian because he said, have you had a massage before? So I said, yeah, kind of. So they ushered us into this room. They said, strip down to your bathing costumes, lay face down on the bed. We had a joint massage. Our beds were next to each other. They said, get changed. We'll go out of the room. We'll come back in 5 minutes. Put a towel around your midriff. And we'll come in about 5 minutes and adjust things. So we were sitting on the bed chatting. I had sort of my hand on my elbow, just waiting for them to come in. So he came in, and I was trying to work out what he was saying. His accent was quite thick, but he said, "Pull your pants down." I said, "Pardon?" I thought sounded a little bit awkward. And so I kind of just moved. I said, "Maybe he needs to kind of get to my spine to the massage." So I pulled it down a little bit, and he said, "No, pull your pants down." So I thought, well, this is really inappropriate and awkward, but we pay good money for this. So when in Rome, yeah. So I pulled my pants down, and Leah had she didn't know any of this going on. She was just enjoying her massage, and I was feeling very vulnerable. It was very inappropriate, and he said no. I said, put your face in the towel. So I'm not sure who was more embarrassed. Me lying there with showing everything, or Arnold Schwarzenegger lookalike, looking at me. I'm sure he's probably sadly still got that memory in his mind as we speak today. It kind of went downhill after that, so our rapport didn't go too well. It's so easy to misunderstand commands and commandments. If you have a children, you know what it's like. You send them off to do something, and they'll come back and do exactly the opposite. And in our reading, we have these set of commandments that God gives to Moses. And maybe when we think of the Ten Commandments, we think these are outdated, they have no relevance to our lives today, or maybe they're just rules which are so impossible to keep. Or maybe this is what the Christian faith is all about, just rules and commandments, rules and commandments. When we christened Ivor earlier, that's what we're committing to, a life of just following a load of rules and commandments. But the Ten Commandments are an invitation into a relationship with the Father through Jesus. That's what these verses are all about. God invites us into a relationship of love through a very real person called Jesus Christ. God is saying, I am the Lord your God. I brought you out of Egypt into a place of freedom. For Israel, it was freedom from slavery in Egypt. For you today, it might be a freedom from addictions or anger or fear or worry or a health issue or loneliness. God says, I brought you out of slavery into freedom. And the response to what God has done is worship. That's what Sarah was saying a bit earlier when we were worshiping. Our response to God of all he's done is worship. Jesus was once asked, out of all these commandments, which one is the most important? And he was talking about the first commandment. It was known as the Shema. And he said, it's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. And he said, the second commandment is this, love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, all the other commandments, they hang on those two things. If you don't get those two things right, you've missed the point of everything else. Love God and love others. And this morning, I want to give you two reasons why this loving God, this worship, is so important for your relationship with God. The first thing is this, worship brings pleasure to God. Worship is the thing that brings pleasure to God. If you're in a healthy relationship with anyone, whether it's your kids or your parent or a partner or even a good friend, you care about the things that they care about. You want to please them. You want to bring joy to their life. And worship brings pleasure to God. If there really is a God and he loves you enough to send his son to die for you, to set you free from all the things you have done, you are doing, and you will do, that there's total forgiveness for you. If there really is a God, and our response to him is worship. That's how God says we respond to him, through worship. Worship is so much more than just music and singing. In 1 Corinthians, it says this, whether you eat or you drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Every activity can be transformed into an act of worship when we do it for God. That's the secret to living a life of worship, doing everything as if you were doing it for Jesus. The Message translation of the Bible puts it like this. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, your eating, going to work, walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Work becomes worship when you dedicate it to God and perform it with an awareness of his presence. Work becomes worship when it's dedicated to God and you perform it with an awareness of his presence. A few years ago, some of you may remember, lots of Christians, we used to have these bands on with WWJD, What Would Jesus Do? And the idea is as you go through your day and someone upsets you or treads on your foot or upsets you in the supermarket, you see the band and it reminds you how you should respond to people. You think to yourself, what would Jesus do if he was in this situation? How do we bring honor to God? And maybe that's a really good question for each of us to ask. How are we honoring God in our everyday lives? Whether it's work or parenting or how we spend the money. When we drive down to Sunbury Cross roundabout and someone cuts in front of us or someone's in the wrong lane, and how do we respond? How are we honoring God with our everyday pieces of life? Worship brings pleasure to God. That's the first thing. Then secondly, worship is the thing that actually grows your relationship with God. Worship grows your relationship with God. We don't worship God because he needs it. We worship God because actually we're the ones who need it. God is passionate about his relationship with you. In that reading that Vera Lynn read to us, one of the commandments, it says, you shall not bow down or worship anything else, for the Lord your God is a jealous God. And that Hebrew word jealous means so much more. It's a positive word. It means he's zealous, he's protective, he's passionate about his relationship with you and me. God is passionate about his relationship with us. There's a psalm that says God confides in those who worship him, who revere him, who obey him. That's who God shares his heart with. Worship grows your relationship with God. It's not a task. It's not another thing you have to do and fit in your life. Worship is a gift that brings life. When we worship, atmospheres change, situations change, hearts change. There's a pastor called Robert Cornwell in the 50s in a place called Oregon in the USA. And he pastored a very small church with just a few people. And he needed some money to help his family to live. So he took a part-time job in a hospital. And in the hospital where he was working, there was, in the ward that they put him in, there was 37 people, all with serious mental health issues. And Robert tried to communicate with them, but none of them would speak back to him. He got nowhere. And he was just so despondent. It was a very dark place. That he just kind of cried out to the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to do here? How can I communicate with these people? And every time he prayed, he just felt the Lord was laying on his heart, worship me. So he fell down to his knees and he worshipped the Lord and nothing happened. Still no one spoke to him. And he left that ward feeling very despondent. Week two, he went back to the ward, fell down to his knees, worshipped the Lord, nothing happened. The same thing happened. Week three, he was at an all-time low. He didn't even bother to speak to anyone. He just fell down to his knees and he just worshipped the Lord. And as he was worshipping, he noticed one of the patients came and kneeled next to him and started to worship the Lord with him. Within 6 months, every single one of those patients was moved off the ward. Within a year, they were all released from the hospital. Many of them became Christians. Some of them joined Robert Cornwell's church because he worshipped and sang over them and committed to them and prayed for them to the Lord. Worship changes atmospheres. It brings pleasure to God. It grows our relationship with God. So how does this work? How does it work? In the New Testament, there's a wonderful verse that says, if we draw close to God, he draws close to us. Draw close to God and he will draw close to you. Whether we've been Christians for years and years, or maybe we wouldn't even class ourselves as a Christian, it doesn't matter. When we set time aside to spend time with the Lord and say how amazing he is, and I'm going to put you first, things change. We begin to see a breakthrough in our lives. That's when we see relationships restored, addictions broken. As we see people who are sick become well. It's as God moves in our hearts, the amazing thing is we actually move the heart of God. and he moves in our situations. And all of this happens in the context of a relationship of love with a real person called Jesus Christ. That's what it happens with in a relationship of love as we worship the Lord. I'd love to just invite the band to come back up on stage. We're going to pray. We're going to spend a bit of time worshiping now. But I'd love for you to ask yourself a question. Where are you today? What are the things that you're struggling with? Where do you need to see a breakthrough in your life with the Lord? Draw close to God and he will draw close to you. Would you like to stand? Sure, many of you will know the encounter of Jesus with the woman at the well. And that encounter was all about worship. Jesus says, the worshippers that the Father loves are those who worship in spirit and in truth. And worshipping God in spirit is just, and truth, is just being honest with God. That woman at the well, you know, she wasn't speaking truth, and Jesus said, actually, the person you live with is not your husband. The Father desires people who are worshipping in truth. And maybe today it's just for you to be honest and truthful with God, saying, this is where I am this morning, Lord. This is where my faith is. This is what I'm struggling with. This is where I need breakthrough. Or this is where I'm disappointed. This is where I have a lack of faith, unbelief. This is where I've prayed and you haven't come through for me. The Father desires us just to worship him in truth, to be honest with him. He knows your heart. But he wants you to admit it, to say, Lord, this is where I am. And then the Father desires those who worship in the Spirit. And we need the Spirit of the Lord. We need his peace, his joy, his power, his strength. We can't do it by ourselves. Just asking, Lord, would you fill us by your Spirit again? Give us the peace we need when the storms come. Give us the strength to stand strong. Give us the power to break those things, Lord, those mountains ahead of us. The Father desires worshippers who worship him in spirit and in truth. So Heavenly Father, we just invite you here this morning. We invite you here by your Spirit. We say, come Holy Spirit, come and fill us afresh with your peace, your joy, and your power. We pray, Lord, that you would soften our hearts. And as we soften our hearts and put you first as our priority, we thank you that somehow we move your heart. Our response to your love is worship, and your response to our worship and praise is to move in our lives and to bring breakthrough. So come, Holy Spirit. Come and fill us, we pray. And God's promise is that when we invite him, he comes. Let's just wait. Let's just pause. And we receive just by saying thank you. It's a gift of faith. It's not about force or ask you to do something you don't want to do, but if you want to receive from him, his promise is that when we ask, he comes. And we just receive by faith by saying, thank you, Lord. I receive your peace this morning. I receive your joy this morning. Come, Holy Spirit. All worship is setting time aside and saying, Lord, you're amazing. I love you. And I put you first. I put you first with my heart, my mind, my strength, my soul. I'm going to trust you with this. And I'm going to be expectant as what you will do. Let's consider to offer those things to the Lord, and the band's just going to lead us in worship. And if you respond to anything this morning or you feel God speaking to you, just feel free just to come to the front. We'll find someone to pray for you over the next few songs. Let's just worship the Lord and let's just receive from him.
Spirit leads. Broken as my life may be, I will give you every peace. I hear you call. Thank you.
sing our final song this morning. And my prayer is that we can take this, the words of this song into our week. That as we wait on the Lord, he will give us his strength. It says in the Bible that as we wait on the Lord, he will renew our strength. And he will give us wings to soar like eagles. Despite our problems, despite the difficulties of our weeks, that actually if we have God with us, and we have his strength with us. Pray that we can take that into our week this week.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
That you are the everlasting God. You do not faint. You do not grow weary. You never change. You are always with us. You are always by our side. We thank you for that. Amen. Well, we have come to the end of our time together. If you would like to receive prayer today, please chat to somebody here and we would love to pray for you. Just come over to the side over there. Do not leave today if you would like to receive prayer. And if you have children in the modular build, don't forget to pick them up. I'm sure that you won't, but just a reminder, just in case. And a big thank you to everybody that has helped make today happen, from hospitality, production, worship, all the different elements. And thank you so much. Let's end with a blessing. The peace of God, which passes all knowledge and understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. The joy of the Lord be our strength. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us today, this week, and evermore. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.